played at the University of Wisconsin. I was a student athlete there, and I joined the staff as an assistant strength and conditioning coach after I graduated. Worked for my mentor through 2008. I took over the Wisconsin program in 2009. Ran that program from 2009 through 2012. Coach Billman took the head job at University of Arkansas. I literally took a red eye from the Rose Bowl to Madison, picked up a suitcase, took another flight to Fayetteville. Just finished my third year at the University of Arkansas. The key with this, fellas, and I'm going to take you through some different things, some different dynamics in regards to how we conduct our business from a training standpoint. There are some things over time, some principles that we have gotten very good results with. One of the things that I'm going to emphasize as we go through is it is the total process. If there's one piece of the puzzle that is not in place, guys that you train will never become who they are capable of becoming. That is key. Every guy that comes into our program, our goal is to help that individual. They all have a different genetic predisposition. Our goal is to help them become that guy that they are capable of becoming in the window of opportunity that we have, which is from 18 to 23. They're not going to be physically the best that they can be until they've been, if their goal is to play in the NFL, and a lot of guys do, a lot of guys don't. Until they've been in the league 4, 5, 6, 7 years, they hit that peak maturity, they'll really become that guy physically they're capable of being. Our job is to set the table and to get, if their genetic ceiling is here, we're not going to get them to the peak of that potential. But we can close that gap as much as possible. And it's a combination of things. It is not just training. That is a piece of the puzzle. What they do, and this is the center of our weight room. When you walk in the door, there's an entry to the weight room, and really this is the center hub. It's one or the other, the pain of discipline or the pain of regret. We refer to it often. It's one or the other. You have to choose. You can't, the two don't go hand in hand. If you don't have the discipline to do the things that we ask you to do day in and day out, week after week, month after month, year after year, you'll never become that guy. Our job is to help set the table, give you the resources to do so, right? If not, you're going to look back at your time, or you're going to look back at your career and think about what I could have done, what else could I have done. And the better guys get, the more we have to refine the process, all right? Some of the keys, and I'm going to move through the next few slides relatively efficiently because I don't want to overlap what my colleague is going to touch on, but the foundation of development is how guys fuel their body from a food and from a fluid standpoint. If they can train like beasts, once they adjust and adapt to stimulus, and we always change the stimulus, if they don't fuel their body frequently throughout the day with nutrient-dense food most of the time, and they don't stay hydrated, they'll never reap the reward of what we do from a training standpoint. You can flip to the next slide. Okay, so we're right here. This is from a supplementation standpoint. UCAN is our primary supplement. Yeah, we know that low glycemic carbohydrate is the body's preferred fuel source, right? So I tell our guys all the time, when the hardest thing to get them to understand is the nutrition concept. They want to train, they want to squat, they want to press, they want to do all these different things. They want to train. What they don't want to do at first is complement that training. We know their body's preferred fuel source is low glycemic carbohydrate. Point in case you can. The challenge is that how do you take that packet and apply it with 120 athletes in an efficient way? We have two ways that we do it. This is a cart that we have 120 shaker bottles that we can accommodate. We actually have two. This accommodates 60 shakers. We have another one that accommodates 60 shakers. This is our weight room based system. The challenge is that you have the packet, you have the shaker. You have 120 athletes using it on a daily basis. So if you look at this wall, you can see every guy, you can't quite see it clearly, but there's a number. Every guy obviously on a 120 man roster has a number. That's his shaker. He comes in literally, now these black bins, that's when we first put it in. We now have stainless steel mounted boxes. So literally when a guy walks into our facility, he walks in. That center desk that you saw, there's the five carbohydrate only options right there. That provides them with five different flavors. We want them to grab a packet and fuel pre-workout. The challenge with anyone is flavor profile. So at first we had chocolate vanilla. In conversation with Peter, we wanted to expand on that so I could get more buy-in. Now we have literally seven different flavor options, five carb only, two that have protein. They walk in, if they don't want the carb only, they walk right around the corner, which they would walk right around here, they grab a chocolate or vanilla. They dump it in your shaker. Add water. I have a Gatorade dispenser. It doesn't dispense Gatorade. All it dispenses is water. All right? They go over, they fill it up, put the top on, shake it, drink it, set it right back in. They're covered. Post-workout, they then do the same thing. They walk in, they get done with their workout, they grab it. It's a protein only. You can, because we want to get some protein in for tissue repair. Shake it, drink it, set it back. Then part of our staff members, they just come through. At the end of the day, we have two dishwashers, two commercial grade dishwashers. They take them, fill the dishwashers, they wash them, they pull them out, set it up, boom, they're ready to roll for the next day. The cart that you saw, we take those on the road with us. We had this great setup, and I said, okay, on the road, we were trying to pull them out of bags and trying to do these all these different things. I had a resource store, we got what I was looking for. How could we be mobile and be efficient and have it be organized? So we created that cart so we can go anywhere in the country. Every road game that we go to, anywhere that we go, that comes with us. You can go to the next slide. One of the biggest challenges, what this is a picture of really, and I'm not gonna get too much into it, but one of the greatest challenges that we have is guys train hard. They train at a high level. This is a picture of our guys. One of our guys is fridge. So anytime we take a guy grocery shopping, we always take, as soon as I show up to their house, or my staff, they show up to the house, take a fridge of his, or a picture of his refrigerator. What you can see, the college athlete, high school's a little different because they have parents in most cases as a resource to help aid in the process. At college, literally there's five pizza boxes, some hot dogs, some eggs, some mayo, some Gatorade, right? All that, the pizza's the bulk majority of it, and a hot dog, it takes 90 seconds in the microwave. When they're hungry, they want to eat now. They don't want to prepare food. They want to eat now. It goes back to, and I tell them, if you train, you can train like a beast. If I starve you, and I don't give you any fluid, the body will consume itself. That's what happens when people starve. The body consumes itself. It doesn't have the nutrients that it needs to not only sustain itself, but to prepare and recover from training. Okay? So they have to understand what they're doing, and we got a lot of creative ways that we get them to understand that. Next slide. This is when we go grocery shopping with the guys. One of the keys, and I feel strongly about this, is a lot of people communicate nutrition in a lot of different ways. One of our strengths, in my opinion, is that we can give it to the guys in a way that they can take and apply. When we go to the store, we'll go through, fellas, what do you like? Tell me what you like. That's where we're going to place our focus. If they like the wrong things, I got to expose them to a lot of things that they haven't tried before. Have you tried avocado as an example? If I got a guy that got a body composition issue, he loves mayo, right? He likes that creamy texture. Have you ever done avocado spread? No. Will you try it? Yes. If you don't like it, I'll buy it back from you. Oh, coach, 90% of the time, oh, I love that. Okay, that's an easy way for us to tie in some healthy fats, so on and so forth. But if it all comes back to nutrient-dense food most of the time. And I tell fellas, I don't need you to never drink. I don't need you to never eat an ice cream sundae or any of those things. Just be smart. Identify what your goals are and be smart about how you tie it all together. Go ahead, next one. Some things that we do that have really worked well for us. It all goes back to, let's set the table for the guy. So if I'm a guy that I know, when I get home, I want to eat. I don't want to have to cook. So Sunday or Monday night preparation is what we'll call it. Four Tupperwares. You can get them for like $3.98 at Walmart. Four Tupperware containers. We actually get three, and we'll go through because this is breakfast. All guys will do, eggs, they're cheap. Guys will always say, well, coach, it's too expensive to eat good. Right? Now we have some resources because the NCAA passed legislation where we can feed them. So we don't have to do this as much. But even if we do, if a guy wants to eat at home, these are eggs and a combination of egg whites. Some Raisin Toast. There's some all-natural organic yogurt on the bottom, some fresh blueberries, strawberries, and apple slices is what this one guy liked. You can eat four meals in a row and not get, by about that fourth meal, you get sick of it. You want to change, right? But then we got four breakfast days. We got Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, or Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, however they want to do it, right? Next one. Lunch. Rotisserie chicken that they can get for $5 from Sam's Club. This is a three cheese tortellini. The guy in this image, he was a linebacker didn't have a body composition issue. We always talk about carbohydrate and timing. You want guys to consume carbohydrate early in the day and start to minimize later in the evening. You need carbohydrates, especially low glycemic carbohydrate, when you need energy. When you don't need energy, scale your carbohydrate intake back. But that's a three cheese tortellini, that's a spinach salad with some fresh mozz and some cherry tomatoes with a little balsamic on the top. Next one. This is lean. You'd be surprised. Very 1% of the guys that come into our program know how to prepare a chicken breast or a piece of fish. Things that are very easy, but if they've never been taught it, all we do, lean protein prep. Get a big packet of chicken breast, 10, 12, 15 chicken breasts. Wash them off really good, get them prepped, put a little olive oil, some salt and pepper, and most of them have Foreman grills, right? Some of them have houses, they have outdoor grills, or they can fry it in a pan, or they can bake it in the oven. But lean proteins, fish as well. There's a lot of times we'll look for deals when they got sales. Again, we can time, lean proteins are expensive, but we find creative ways to get them in the guy's diet in a way that they can actually afford it. Next one. Dinner. This is just an example. Sweet potato, a little bit of brown sugar, piece of salmon, piece of fish. He's covered the whole week. Breakfast, he has his pre and post workout in his UCAN options. Lunch, dinner. Pre-bedtime, we'll just put 20 grams of a protein blend in their system before they go to sleep to enhance recovery from training stress. Next one. When we talk about development, we set the table with, they hydrate, and from a hydration standpoint, our guys have a gallon jug. Or we take it next step further. If they're willing to make a $60 investment, they get a hydro flask. All a hydro flask is just less than a gallon, 64 ounces. It keeps colds cold for 12 hours. Keeps colds cold for 24 hours, hots hot for 12. It's an aluminum container, has a 100-year warranty. We tell them, just make the one-time investment. You don't have to replace a gallon jug every 3 to 4 days because of bacteria buildup, right? Once we got the table set with all of those things, there are a lot of things that over time I've developed to get the buy-in component. Because as soon as I get a guy, his pores are open, Coach Herb, I want to do it. I want to do it right. Okay. We track everything. Because if I track it and he has success, all I do is take it and tell the rest of the knuckleheads in the group that don't want to listen, what don't you get? Just don't be your worst enemy, right? Come with me. You're going to put mass on a guy primarily in two areas. In his back and in his legs, where your largest muscle groups are. Challenge with back training and any pulling movement is the guys, they never see. They never stand in the mirror. They're looking at the anterior side of their body. They're not looking at their upper back. They're not looking at their lower body, their glute, their hamstring development. We'll take pictures. This was a tight end, and you'll see his before and after photo later. He was doing a face pull. This guy was 202 pounds when he came into the program. He's 256 right now. We had the Mackey Award winner, the best tight end in the country, Hunter Henry. This kid may win it next year. He's a beast. Jeremy Sprinkles his name. I took that picture. I showed it to him. He was shocked. That's my back? Go to the next one. Another, this is a picture of one of our tailbacks. Again, doing a reverse rib chin, and then go to the next one. That's doing an overhand chin. I always give them visual stimulus of the things that they can't see. So they understand, Coach, why do we do so many chins? Why do we work different grip variations? Why do we do all these different things? This is why. Your mass is going to come in two areas. And in some of the digital body shots, you'll see the lower body development component. Go back to those other slides for me. Let's go down to right here, Dean. I'm gonna show you guys some of these digital body shots. We'll progress through these, and one of the biggest things you'll see, fellas, is from a deficiency standpoint, 99.9% of the time, when the guys come in, we get freshmen to walk in the door. Their deficiencies are in their pulling movements. If a guy can press 225 14 times, he can pull it four. And then their lower body development. And I'll get into some of the lower body training mechanics in a second. But you're going to see guys, just look at overall their shoulder development, their lower body development. And it's when we look at gaining weight is not gaining weight. Coach, I want to gain weight. No, you don't. You want to add fat to your frame? No, I want to add muscle. Exactly. So it's always increasing lean mass. Indeed, Coach, I don't want to lose weight because I can take a guy in the sauna and I can strip 12 pounds off him just like that. You want to lose fat. Increasing mass, decreasing fat. Go ahead and scroll through the next one. This is what we call it, guys like this, young skill guys, noodles, guys that have no bumps. This is a guy, literally South Florida kid, had no concept of fueling his body. Would go hard, would train at a high level, put 32 pounds of mass on his frame in 17 months. Feeding his body, and then developing those areas we talked about. Go ahead, we'll just scroll through these. Just let these guys see some of the transformations.
Is this all of them for 17 months?
No, their windows are all a little bit different. Some guys it's a year, some guys it's 3 years. And this is a way when we talk about the buy-in factor, when we start to show them, everybody responds to visual stimulus. When we show them how they change over time, they all of a sudden, they get it. That's Hunter Henry, the kid that was the best tight end in the country this year.
I got a question. What metrics do you use? I know like different positions probably require different stuff, but like in terms of your big like percentage of body fat guy, like
I don't even
know. You don't even look at
this. Is all I look at. It's this simple because I've gone to the point where we'll evaluate from the DEXA. It's really the only thing that I'll use to evaluate body composition based on its reliability. You can look at a guy, strip a guy down, put him in his compression shorts, look at him. Is he lean? Yeah, it doesn't matter if he's 9% or he's 12%. Is he lean? Does he have a body mass or a body fat issue that's going to hinder his abilities? No. Look at this guy. Does he have a body fat issue? Yes, it's plain as day. So we do everything visual because as soon as you start to chase those numbers, if the two of us, we're competitive, say we're both safeties, and we do a DEXA, you're 10.7 and I'm 9.2, these guys are sitting over there going, I got to be 9.1, right? It's not even about chasing those numbers because they're irrelevant. It's like we don't chase weight room numbers either because it doesn't do us any good. As soon as we show them the visual stimulus of just physically, that's the tight end I was talking about. It all takes care of itself.
When you start to chase weight room numbers, you're talking about overall maxes?
I'm going to get there in a second. Let's go to the videos. There should be... So when we look at the most valuable, if you could just pause that for a second, the most valuable components of what we do, and in the weight room, numbers 100% of the time take care of themselves. Never, and I've been with our head football coach a long time since 2004, never once has he said, we need this guy to do, you know, squat 525 or bench, da da da. Numbers will take care of themselves. Everything that we do from a training standpoint, the quality of the movement sets the table for everything. Because if the quality of the movement isn't high, not only they won't reap the reward of that movement, but the likelihood of them getting put in a bad situation, increasing the risk of injury, drastically increases. Pull-ups as an example. It's one of our primary, again, when we pull vertically, we pull horizontally. So our favorite vertical pulls are overhand chins, neutral grip chins, reverse grip chins. And when he does it, go ahead, he sticks it at the top, he comes down with control, he fully extends, and then he repeats. Go ahead and pause that. Every time, it all goes back to consistency. When we tell him this is how we want it done, the quality of the movement, he's fully extended. He pulls, he squeezes it, and he comes down control. It increases the muscle's time under tension. It gives us a better hypertrophy effect in terms of breaking the muscle down increasing in size. Go ahead and go to the next one. The overhand chin is a go-to movement for us to develop the back. The neutral grip chin, same thing. Go ahead and play it. He's fully extended. He squeezes at the top, touches the shoulder to the handle, and he always comes down with great control. And then the final variation, the reverse grip chin. Now, again, the biggest difference in terms of if guys, you guys ever get guys, go ahead and pause that for me. You guys, we have to be as efficient as we can be. So guys that like to do any bicep or tricep work, I always try and find movements that I can actually tie it into the workout. Reverse grip chin is, you get an amazing bicep movement, plus you get the benefit of training your back at the same time. Go ahead. The bilateral squat, or just regular double leg squat. Go ahead and play. The key, and everybody does it, I shouldn't say everybody, a lot of people do it a little bit differently. The biggest thing, when you watch Santos squat here, you go ahead and pause. Can you play that for me one more time? Once he gets down to the bottom, to the depth of that squat, can you pause it for me? Right there. So he's at the base of the squat. Again, what I would want to see is, and sometimes guys have mobility issues, but when we squat, we look at glute hamstring development. You're going to get glute hamstring development in the depth of the squat, right? As long as their hamstring is flexible enough to tolerate that depth, sometimes guys, their lumbar spine will pull under because their hamstrings are too tight. He can sit deep. When they squat, I want their feet slightly outside their hips, their toes out a tad. I want to push their butt back. I want a nice vertical shin. That's right where I want to be. Boom, stand tall. I don't care if there's, we have guys that put 705 pounds on the bar and do it that way. We have guys that put 140 pounds on the bar and do it that way. If you don't do it this way, the load is too heavy. Because the load, increased load isn't going to do anything for me. All it's going to do is hinder my depth. So if the weight's too heavy and I don't squat deep, I'm not getting my glute and hamstring stronger. You get the coach that says, he only squats, 275. Look at how he does it. He's going to get stronger. Again, you can do a lot of different things. You want to go chase numbers. It's a lot of wasted time. But sometimes we can talk through it. Guys get put in those peer pressure situations. This will make him a better, stronger football player and help him reduce the risk. Numbers will only appease a guy that doesn't know, most likely. He doesn't have any clue what he's talking about. He just wants to be able to say, I got a guy that squats 5'10". Yeah, he does it like this.
My question is, does it put on, because I was told that, in fact, that's what I'm going to check. Does that put a lot of pressure on the knee joints?
Reduces pressure on the knee joint. This is where guys get into trouble. As soon as they drop below 90, a lot of that pressure is dispersed throughout the lower body. Shin angle. His shin angle is slightly forward, but it's not this. As soon as I drift forward, all that stress is getting redistributed to the patella. When I sit back and I keep a nice vertical shin, there's minimal stress on the knee, especially when I'm in the depth of the squat. And if you have guys that have one of the easiest, most efficient ways, if we ever get guys, which rarely we do, that their patella gets inflamed, it usually goes back to the quad and IT band. If we reduce tension through soft tissue work in the quad and the IT, it usually eliminates any soft tissue or any patella issues that we may have. But that's the key. His shin angle, and sometimes it's ankle mobility, and sometimes it's hamstring mobility. If a guy can't sit in that position, which sometimes guys won't be able to, a lot of guys, if their ankles are stiff, you elevate their heel and they can do it, you know it's an ankle mobility issue. But if they can't sit in that position, go to the next one. This is one of the easiest. For squatting is hard to do mechanically the right way, especially with junior high and high school age kids. This movement, pause it for me.
Is it ankle or what?
Ankle mobility or hamstring. It depends on what you see. But this movement, is one of our, again, we double leg squat and we do a lot of single leg squatting variations. This is one of the single leg squatting variations that we do. If we have a guy that lacks ankle mobility or has hamstring issue, mobility or flexibility wise, and he can't get in the position we need, we do this on its own, but that guy then will do only this movement. He won't do a bilateral squat. This stand is a Soreneck stand. It's a $189.99 investment. It will change your lower body training program like right now. Because all of those guys that can't, this is not an easy position to get into. Some guys, they can get into it and it's easy and it's, you won't have any issues. Other guys, you're trying to put them in that position, it looks terrible, right? Then they can't even do it body weight wise, and then you're gonna put weight on their back. It's a recipe for disaster. You elevate their right foot. His left foot now is gonna function independently. So as soon as he elevates that right foot, and you see guys' legs will start to shimmy and shake, all of those stabilizers are forced to activate. Everything else, you look at the pattern of the movement, everything else is the same. However, there no longer is a mobility issue. Go ahead and watch. Shin position is the same. Thigh to glute position is the same. He comes down, next slide. It'll just be the other side so you can see it a little bit. It's a Soreneck. Single leg squat stand is what they call it. And he comes down with great control. He lightly touches the back knee and he stands tall. Now, not only do you get all the benefits of the bilateral double leg squat, but you also get the benefit of a single leg squat as well, which forces each eye to function independently. A lot of times, young guys especially, we force a guy to function independently, whether in a pistol squat or whether in a rear foot elevated foot squat, you're gonna have a strength discrepancy. It's a great way for us to identify and address those issues.
Ben, is that knee touching that pad?
That pad. This is an RX pad. You can get, you just go to Perform Better. It's an RX pad.
And as soon as it touches, that's when he...
As soon as it touches, and it literally, the stand is everything because you can adjust it. People will do it off of benches and chairs and a lot of different things. Make the investment, even if you can get two or three, add to it over time. The stand is adjustable. But literally, a guy steps under the bar, we start to teach it body weight. So literally, they just take body weight, elevate their foot, they come down nice and controlled, they touch the knee, they stand tall and stabilized. I want to see this. Nice vertical shin, control, touch, stand tall, stabilize. Body weight, 20 each leg. Once they get through that, weighted vest, two weighted vest, light dumbbells, two weighted vest, heavier dumbbells, then they put the ball on their back. Because now they've shown us that they have the capability to handle the movement pattern, and then we start to expose them to the load. The game changer.
Yeah.
And then go to the last one for me. From a pressing standpoint, everybody, we do a lot of pressing variations. We press with dumbbells, we press with a straight bar, we press with a wider grip, we press with a close grip. Dumbbell pressing is our primary, if I'm gonna lay on a bench and press, dumbbells are our primary pressing movement. Why? Because I can change the hand position, which helps alleviate stress on the shoulder, and it forces each side to function independently. Just from a simple pressing progression, you'd be shocked. Go ahead and play that for Santos. Pause up top right there. When we get into a push-up position, how I view a push-up, a proper push-up, his heels are tight together. His feet, there's no space. As you look at the line of his body, his glutes are tight, his low back, his core is rock solid. There is no sag. His head is in line. Everything, we talk about a steel rod mentality. Everything is in a perfectly straight line. So when those guys set up, he's literally right here. That's how it looks. Big guys especially, just to get in that position and hold it for 30 seconds, this is what they want to do. And it comes back to their core. Once they're here, they want to let their glutes go, and they want to go like this. I want their head, or they drop their chin, or they pull their head back. Everything's in a perfectly straight line. And then as he does it, go ahead and play that for me one more time. He comes down with control. He presses strong and he stabilizes up top. Once they can show us that, then we'll put a bar in your hands, then we'll put a dumbbell in your hands. Again, and it's always show us control, touch, drive, stabilize. Wrist position, a lot of guys want to let that bar bend back. When they grab the bar, they grab it like they're holding on for their life because it creates tension in the rest of the arm, through the shoulder, into the pec, in the upper back. They're here if I'm going to press or I'm going to close grip or I'm going to take a regular bench with grip is how we refer to it. They take that bar off, their upper back's pulled tight, which a lot of guys, don't ever let a guy take the bar off the rack on his own. Because when we set them up on the bench, we want their upper back pulled tight together, their shoulder blades pulled tight. If they press the bar up, all of a sudden they lose their foundation because it spreads their shoulder blades apart. Upper back is tight, they bring the bar off, they come down with control, and they drive it up and they stabilize it at the top. Dumbbell, same thing. Show me control, press stabilize. Push-up position. We'll do TRX push-ups, a lot of different pressing variations. But the quality of the movement, if it's not done that way, it's wrong. And I make sure they understand why. And then I make sure they understand why it's important not to do it again. Because those coaching cues, sometimes guys just don't listen. You see a guy drop his chin. Was I not clear in my coaching cues? No, coach, you were clear. Okay, let's do five up-downs because he didn't get it. He might have got it, but he didn't take it and apply it. It's no different than we talk a lot about when a coach gives you a message. If you do what the coach asks, most likely you're going to be successful. If you don't, most likely you're not. So it's no different than our coaching cues. We want them to be, it's the quality of the movement. Load takes care of itself. You'll decrease the risk of injury, and you'll increase the quality of what that athlete gets out of the training session. Those are just some general things that I wanted to show to you guys in terms of how we conduct our business. Any questions, thoughts, things that you want me to touch on? Yes.
One of the toughest movements I find with high school is teaching them the front squat. We like to use the clean grip rather than crossing the arms type. Are there any pointers that you would use for the younger guys? I don't like to go to the front squat until they have the body weight squat down.
Yep.
Like you said, that progression from body weight to dumbbells and weighted vests and things like that before you even get to a bar. We like to use just body weight with the younger guys. And then what I find is that wrist flexibility and getting those elbows out is very difficult to teach.
And you hit it on the head. Yeah. We don't front squat. Not because I don't like the front squat, I love the front squat. But not only do guys have a hard enough time back squatting, now all of a sudden you take an ankle mobility issue, possibly a hamstring mobility issue, and then you throw a wrist mobility issue into that. You have a large number of guys that all of a sudden can't do it how you want, which is I like two fingers under the bar, I want the elbow high to support the load, especially when it gets heavy. They can't do it. If a high percentage, 90% of the guys I'm asking to do, we'll always accommodate 10-15%. But if the high percentage of the guys can't do it with very light weight to the point of what I want, I'm trying to chase something. Okay, wrap the strap around the bar and bring your elbows up. Cross your arms, da da da. You're chasing. It's a great movement, but it's not that important to the point where I gotta try and manipulate three different factors to even get a guy in a position.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah, no, I mean, one of the main reasons why we try to do that is number one, I think they get a little bit more depth out of the front squat. Mm-hmm. Just, with that age group, they seem to be, dropping the butt down a lot lower. But the main focus was to develop the wrist flexibility so that they can apply it to the clean.
And that's, When you apply it to the clean, which we don't clean, for those same examples. Yeah. Not because I don't think it's a great movement to apply force into the ground. Yeah. It is an Olympic sport for a reason. It is a highly technical movement, yeah. Right? Yeah. So I came up on the platform. And I would always watch, as soon as, with lighter loads, guys would be on point. Whether they start from the ground in a power position, or they start from a hang, they can get in that great position. They can pull the bar. Some guys that have wrist issues, you always get frustrated because they can generate the power. They catch it here. Mm-hmm. You can do that with lighter loads. If you try and do that with 405, that's not happening.
Right.
If you can't get the elbows through to support the weight, when you drop deep to stand up with it, you're never going to be able to move weights. You've got these strong, powerful guys getting super frustrated because the wrist is holding them back. All these different factors, then you start to get heavy. Guys are catching it. As soon as their mechanics change, it's wrong. Guy catching a weight and he's like this and he's standing up, everybody's going crazy. I'm like thinking to myself, I love that you got the weight. And I could go put it on the sheet and tell coach you got the weight. When I watched it, I cringed and was like, that hurt me. It probably wasn't good for you. You know what I mean? Then the more research I did, and I got with, being from Pittsburgh, I got with Buddy Morris at Pitt, who's, you know, took me through a whole mindset of different ways to look at things. The force production into the ground can be recreated through med ball work, through plyo work, except for when the loads get really heavy. When measured on a force plate, you can't duplicate it. It's the best way to produce force into the ground. However, in a college setting, we're not preparing guys at the Olympic Training Center for Olympic movements, so it's not that level. So when the loads get heavy, as soon as the mechanics change, everything else goes out the window. It wasn't worth the lack of quality that I was seeing, and also putting a guy in a bad situation because his ego's driving him to outclaim the guy next to him.
Yeah, chasing numbers.
Yeah, and then once we started going out, we got a lot of football players having a lot of success. I didn't even have to have that conversation anymore.
So a lot of it now is with the, the resistance stuff, the controlling of the movement,
Those are just some examples. Anything that we do slow and controlled, we do fast and sudden as well. Yeah. And again, we'll do some box squat variations that we'll attach it to a tendon, no different. Because I want to see guys, we measure strength, their ability to take that strength and produce force. So as an example, if a guy, and we'll have guys, our linemen across the board, say you got a guy that can press 410, you got a guy that can press 370, single 1RM on the bench. You take that same guy, attach him to a tendo unit, which we can measure speed of the bar and power output. They come down with control, and they accelerate the bar. The guy that presses 370 moves it at, 870, he produces 875 watts of power. The guy that presses, 410 only produces, 840. How he converts his strength to power is football. But we look at those things. It's no different in a squat. I want guys to move with bar speed. We do max effort work. We do repetition work. We do bar speed work. We tie in, I don't know if you're familiar with the conjugate method, but looking at all the areas of those principles. You're only as strong as your weakest link. If we have guys that are, have grade 1RMs, they can't convert it. Usually guys that can't convert it can't play the game. And if you don't combine, if you don't turn strength into speed and power, you're trying
to simulate the field.
Yeah, well, you're just taking a great strength development. Guys that are stronger can produce more force. But I'm not measuring, this guy's strong because he can squat, 6'10". If he can't hold a front plank, if he can't do a single arm, it's the total package. How balanced is he from head to toe? I'm not identifying a guy in a squat rack because I've seen guys that can squat the house that can't play. I've seen guys that can squat the house that are beasts. But usually it's the total package of what he can do across the board that determines how he's going to translate it to the football field. I see guys that are great in all areas from a training standpoint. They can't follow directions, right? They don't play. And so that's where I always link it back to, fellas, follow my direction, you'll be more likely to follow the position coach's direction. If you follow his direction, he's going to trust you and in turn put you on the field to play football. But you didn't come here to wave the towel. If you did, okay, cool, go be that guy.
One last question. We try to make it fun for the kids, for the high school kids. Any strategies that you use in your weight room I know competition's big. I try to make everything a competition as much as I can. Because our guys, they won't show up if they're not having fun. If they're just constantly being drilled and drilled and drilled every day, it's just going to become monotonous, and then they stop coming. So I try to make it fun. Are there any strategies that you use in your weight room to make it enjoyable for them?
A lot of strategies. I love personality. I love juice. Like, I love guys, when they come to train, you're always going to have those days. Ah, I got to go see Coach Herb. I got to go grind, you know. But they know coming in the room, it's a vibrant place. And they know the main thing is, fellas, I'm not here to tell you what to do and, you know, be this tough guy. No, I want to help turn you into a beast, right? And bring juice, bring personality. There's a lot of different ways, from the music to competition to just a place that they know, like, I'm not trying to be a hard ass. I want to help you get right. So when they come in, their mindset's already, when they wake up that day, and I let them know how you think of myself and my staff, like, I'm not trying to be your boy either.
Right.
We need to conduct our business a certain way, but at the same time, they know, you know, we're going to fly around and have fun and, you know, do what we do, you know, and it's just endless. You gotta just bring personality to the table, and you gotta let those guys bring their personality to the table. And we got guys that bounce off the walls. I dump gas on them and love that. It literally, you know, figuratively speaking, you know, that's all. Like, hey, don't be this. You know, some of these dudes are wound up so tight and are loose cannons. And rather than be like, stand up straight. There's times that I tell them, we're gonna lock in, lock in. If you're a guy that's bouncing off the wall, we got guys that stand there, don't say a word. But don't, you know, they rub off on one another, you know? And so that's what I love. Those guys that like to be wild, they got that natural energy. You know, that I like that, just so that they know when it's time, you know, when the music's not bumping, we're coaching something, we're giving cues, whatever we're doing, understand the time and place. When we turn that thing up and it's time to go, bounce off the walls, I'm going to try and throw you high, you know, like.
They use the music at the practices too?
Yeah.
Yep.
That's big now. And they dictate the music. I used to be, you know, I'm going to dictate the music. I thought I had a good feel for what the guys wanted to play. Then I got to the point where, okay, got to make a comment. And I'd be like, all right, you're the DJ.
Yeah.
Well, then why is he going to be the DJ? I want to be the DJ. So then we would have competitions. Okay, what do you guys want to listen to? Because we got a melting pot of personalities. You got guys that listen to hip hop. That's all they've ever listened to. You got guys that listen to country. You got guys that listen to heavy metal. What are the three? What do you want? Well, I want heavy metal. I want country. I want boozy. Okay. Go grab three pairs of 75-pound dumbbells. They come over. They're all over. All right. Stand there. They stand. They just look at each other in a circle. Got it. You know, you got both dumbbells. Right? Guy who holds that second, you got to set one down, that's fine. Whoever has one dumbbell left in their hand, that's what we're going to listen to today.
There you go.
And then they dictate it. You know, so that stuff, it all, you know.
You do that for jersey numbers, too. Everybody wants number one.
Yeah, but we'll turn anything into a competition. Yeah. A big one, rock, paper, scissors.
Yeah.
Because what they get into is, I would do it, pull a number, like we would do everything. It always comes back to you. You decide, right? You dropped the dumbbell. I didn't. Why are you getting pissed at me? You threw scissors. He threw paper. Like, you earned the right to win. You picked the music or, you know, whatever it may be. I put it all back on them, you know? And they get a chance physically. One of the best ones, I'll give, you know, we have tiles. You walk the line. I like violent, you know, it's a violent, aggressive sport. Other than really the quarterback in the specialist position, there's a violent and aggressive nature to all things. We like to tie those principles in, but you walk a fine line when you do that. One of our favorite, but I only tie it in periodically, is we have just a towel, like a regular, not a wash rag, but like a hand towel. We'll throw it out in the middle, we'll pick two guys. There's no headbutt, no punching or kicking, but literally, he got one hand on the towel, he got one hand on the towel, take it from him. And we'll do things at the end where, okay, defense, you pick a guy, pick a beast, anyone you want. Offense, you pick a guy. Whoever wins, you know, they don't have to do, you know, whatever. We'll do other things where you got, I'll pick two guys. So, yeah, you two, you come up. The rest of the team is out there. This is what we're going to do. You pick the guy you think's going to win. So we get guys go over there. Sometimes the best is when you get two or three guys go over here, and I'll set the table sometimes. Because I'm always watching. I'll know a guy subtly is really good at something that the rest of the guys won't know. And I'll pick out another guy that's a beast, but I have a good feel that that guy that no one thinks is going to win, I think he will. Two guys will come over there, you get 60, we'll go over there. And then this dude ends up wearing him out, and the, you know, those dudes go crazy. And but the key with any competition, when we do competition, the loser, the price that they pay is steep. It's not like, oh, you lose, so you're going to do 10 out now. No, it's like, if you lose, you know, you're going to do 125 up-downs. You know, and we blend it. We got to pick the right time and where we're at in the training cycle. But when they lose, they know, you know, the price to pay. Because you don't go out and lose on game day. It's, oh, you know, I no, it, you know, it should hurt you there. And if it doesn't, something's wrong. Good?
Yeah, I got one. I was just going to say, I work with a lot of junior high kids. Age appropriate, start lifting. Like, what's too, what do you say is like too early? What's just right? Does it depend on the kid? Like,
it, you know, I have a 2-year-old son and a 5-year-old son. As soon as I feel that they can understand the technique of what I'm looking to expose them to, they will start. Because I grew up really not knowing, like, oh, don't put a weight on your back, it'll stunt your growth. Like, oh,
yeah, no. Yeah, yeah.
This is the difference. A very beginner lifter and a very advanced lifter can perform the same movement. The difference is with most movements. Let's use this squat as an example. An advanced lifter is going to put 700 pounds on his back. A beginner lifter is going to put, it may be a PVC pipe on his back. The load dictates what they're capable of doing, but getting them introduced to the movement pattern, you know, at any age, always use the body weight as a foundation. Make sure the movement pattern is what you want. And then as they adjust and adapt to that stimulus, gradually increase it. As soon as the movement pattern changes where it's not, I don't want to see that, nope, stop the load. Yeah, that looks great, bump the load.
Thank you. Just 2 quick ones. When do you decide to increase the weight? I know you focus on the phone. When you say, like, after you slow and control the inverse, you decide, okay, what about the weight for you guys? X amount.
As long as the movement looks good, we want load. I'm not saying don't load. We want to load. But we'll never load them at the sacrifice and the detriment of the quality of the movement. If the quality of the movement looks great to you, put some load on it. Because guys, naturally, they want to put weight in their hands, they want to put it on their back, they want to expose themselves to weight. Mm-hmm. When it's not done properly, it's too heavy. If it's done properly, put some weight on.
And the last one is like, how do you guys take out Olympic lifts, because we use that for explosive purposes. How do you translate the speed on the field? My lineman, I always teach them power clean, is coming out of your swing as quick as that first thing. It's like, oh, you're exploding into them.
This is the key. Everybody gets into the hip extension component. What extends your hips? I'm here, right? I step, I'm going to extend into somebody. You're here in this position. What extends the hips? My glutes. My glute is rock solid right now. If I don't fire my glutes, my hips don't extend. I squeeze my glutes, my hips extend. Hip extension is a result of the glute. You have great glutes. That's why glutes are so important in terms of speed and explosiveness. Your glutes extend your hips. Then once you have the glute development, you develop glute and strength. Now it's about taking it and applying it. Olympic lifting is one way to apply hip extension. Jumping is no different. When you come out of your legs, what happens? You extend your hips. I got a med ball on my chest. My hips are set. What happens? I extend my hips. If I'm doing a jammer, I'm setting in either a rotational position or in a set position. Extend your hips. Develop the glute, strengthen the lower body so that you can promote and produce more force into the ground. And then hip extension takes care of itself. Olympic lifting is just one means to develop hip extension and explosive power. But you can get it in other areas. And the key for me with that is other areas that easily they can take and apply day after day after day. I don't have to dedicate 60 minutes, time after time. And then you invest all that time, and a lot of guys still can't do it for other factors that you got to, you know, it's just a, and I'm not saying don't do it by all means. If you want to do it, do it. This is just where I am and how I've evolved in my outlook.